So who's waiting to talk to us down here?
The Eastern Plain is finally open for travel. I hear that the people of Stoneberry are alive and well. My husband and I can breathe a sigh of relief.
I wasn't worried about him at all.
He talks tough, but he was really worried. Oh, sorry you don't know who we're talking about. It's his apprentice.
What kind of apprentice?
My husband's an architect. Even the royal family and the abbey commission his work. He's been at the docks here on a job. He just finished, and we're about to return to Logris.
These people don't care about all that.
Why did your apprentice go to Stonebury?
He's young and talented, but a bit eccentric. He said he wanted to help create a new town, so he set off to the frontier.
A craftsman has to focus on his work. Creating a new town. Ha! He should know his place.
But my husband didn't disown him. That boy's fearlessness reminds me of my husband when he was young.
So you understand how he feels then?
I didn't say that. If he thinks he has the talent, he's free to do as he likes. But if he doesn't follow through with it to the end, I'll be done with him.
Did you hear that? He thinks the boy can do it. If you ever find yourself in Stonebury, go visit that boy's workshop.
Right, I'll do that.
Sorry about my husband. He can be a real grump.
Don't worry about it. I'm pretty used to people like that.
Hey, what's that supposed to mean?
It means exactly what you think it means. You were pretty insufferable for a long time. Every single conversation.
I don't care about anyone. I'm so dark and broody, and I'm going to take over the world.
That's not what she said. Let's see. So east of the capital. Yeah, that's gotta be it, right down there.
I think I've finally gotten used to it.
Used to what?
Your powers. I think I finally got a handle on them in a way that feels right.
That's good. Hopefully you won't faint anymore.
Yeah, and I'll keep learning too. I hope we can make this work out.
Yeah, definitely. Fingers crossed. What's wrong?
Nothing.
Hey! When you and Eleanor made your pact together, she gave you a true name, right? Was it a good one?
True name? What's that?
It's a special name in the ancient tongue given to a Moloch as a necessary step in forming a pact with a human. I gave Bienfu the name Fushikas. It means thing.
That's pretty messed up.
It's just my own little way of showing affection.
So what kind of name did you get, Lafayette? What's the matter? She didn't give you a really weird name like Mogulu gave Bienfu, did she? If you're not happy with it, I can talk to Eleanor about it later. So go on and tell me.
I'm fine with it. And I can't tell you anyway.
Well, you don't have to get so worked up about it.
A true name is not something a Moloch just casually divulges to others. They carry a special meaning to us. Speaking it to anyone other than our Pact Keeper carries a special meaning. Between comrades, it means we trust them with our lives. In other cases, it's
practically a confession of love!
You could have said something sooner, you know.
Lafayette's at a delicate age. You should be more careful in the future.
Oh, really? It's just another way of showing affection.
So, of course, Mogulu's just casually throwing names around because she can. Also, she totally did that just to dig the dagger deeper because she knows, like, this whole thing where Velvet feels uncomfortable about how Lafayette's growing attached to Eleanor instead of her because she has the feelings of, like, how it reminds them of their own sibling, and that gets weird really fast. And now this is happening. But they're like, oh, by the way, they have a special name they can't tell you. Ooh, Velvet.
Be the demon Tabitha wanted us to know about.
It's flying free, but could it still be a Therian?
I just felt an Earth Pulse point. It's that way! Somewhere near the top of that mountain!
Let's check it out.
Oh... Wait... Wait, is this place gonna seem really familiar? Like a certain place where we fought a dragon in Zesteria? Is that where we're going? Ooh, stat plant. That could be, like we're already having little signs of that by having eyes and be like,
a dragon.
Like, what if we go to the exact place where we find Aizen in Zesteria, where he is a dragon? That would be a thing. Plan to Vitality. It was a hellhole when we got there, right? But that's the kind of thing that they might do to, like, make it feel different between the two things. Be like, oh, look how vibrant it used to be, or look what a wasteland it used to be, and stuff like that. To contrast it with how it looks in the other game! Ah! Bees are fast. What level are you guys, by the way? 36. Looks like I'm falling behind again. Ow. Ow. I'm getting stung a lot. There we go. There we go. Give me all those combo points. One by one. Yep, they're not gonna last now. Pain time! Just do me a favor and melt for me. Gotcha.
Not bad.
That grade bonus thing. It'd mean more if I ever grinded for more than 30 seconds against anything. But that's me. So is this the way we're trying to go? There's definitely a code red down here at the very least. May as well try to visit that area. Keep out of the way of bees. I'm bummed out code reds don't give you a bunch of experience, though. They should. Like, that's like the point of having a big enemy encounter, is to give your player all the rewards in the world for doing the big tough thing. And experience should be one of those things, shouldn't it? Almost seems to defeat the purpose a little bit. They do other things, and they give you money, and often like unique drops and things like that, but experience, come on, man. Instead, they only really give you large chunks of experience for completing story fights, the story boss fights, and large amounts of grinding. But that's a drip feed by comparison to how much you get from a single story boss encounter where it just drowns you in several thousand. Well, it's a big open area. Easy to avoid encounters I don't want to do. If I don't just go charging through it like I did earlier. Look at the peacock. Time for one of these. Hey, buddy. Buddy. Buddy, buddy. A foe worth killing. King Peacock, level 42. Maybe time to start doing grinding again soon. What's the point of even having the top of the screen show what attacks are being used, by the way? Look how many of them are showing up, because it shows every single one for every party member in one dedicated slot. With no sorting, it doesn't give you elemental indications of what the attacks are. It doesn't tell who's casting it. It just says whether or not they're a melee attack or casting a spell, and that's it. That's all the help they give you. Pain time. Yay. Let's bring it in. Here it comes! Just gonna keep this going for a little while if I can. Okay, watch out. Oh, that was a miss. Come on, charge it up. There we go. You don't seem to be doing so well if I just... I'm just gonna come out and say it. Are there points just hanging out around the map? I was gonna say, I can't beat any more out of them. Here we go. Ooh, it's a bad time for you. We're at about 25%. Aha, I blocked it. Oh, crap. Didn't block that. Make it count. Also, you revive him. Oh, trying to make a count. I screwed up and stopped blocking at the wrong time. Oh, leave me alone. Ah, oh. Well, that's not good. That's distinctly a bad thing. Come on. Just knock a combo point out of him. That did not happen. Crap. That's bad. Just kind of wasting his time for a while there. There we go. We need to beat those points back out of him. Or just finish him off at this point, I guess. Really close. Oh, dang. Severe. I should be able to beat him in just a second, though, so I don't think I need to revive. Yeah, he's, like, right at the on the edge of dying. I always forget, though, if this is a game where being dead means you don't get experience or something. It varies a lot from game to game. Zero experience. Such a bummer. Grants plus one maximum souls to characters wearing equipment that has been enhanced. A combined total of 20 or more times. Whoa. It increased to maximum souls? I want... That's a decent incentive to start start combining more equipment, too. So can I not take those doors? They're not highlighted. They must be inaccessible, I suppose, judging by the coloration. Okay, I've looped all the way back around to where I came from, since that was a pretty big detour to get the Code Red encounter. So that's where we came in the first place, somewhere over there. And we need to go down this little fork to find our way here. Oh, they're big. Must avoid bees. They will catch me, apparently. They're really fast. I wonder if you can dodge them to the side, since they have to give you the tools you need to avoid fights if you want to. So I wonder if maybe...
I can really feel the earth pulse now. It's up above.
Guess we're in for some mountain climbing, then.
I find myself wondering whether or not the bee is charged in straight lines or something, and you can just sidestep them or something. Gotcha. Gotta grab every single one. Although now I need to try to remember where the previous ones were I couldn't open, because that's a whole thing unto itself. Ooh, hi. Got some boots. So is this place familiar? Kind of? Maybe? I don't know. It's just a high spot covered in stuff. Eh. Don't have a lot to draw on. Could be grasping at straws, narratively. Let's see if I can sneak around it. Nope.
I can't wait to take a good look around. Whoa, now that's what I call a view.
I agree that it's beautiful, but don't leap about so much. You'll fall.
I can sense many earth pulses under this place.
I figured you'd notice that. An intricate web of earth pulses crisscrosses the land under the Aldina Plains. Mountains like these would normally take tens of thousands of years to form, but these popped up in about a millennia.
So the earth pulses have affected the land?
Exactly. Long ago, people wielded arts that allowed them to manipulate the earth pulses and control the very land itself.
How could arts like that exist?
Perhaps they pushed against key points on the earth pulses? Like how acupressure can improve a person's blood flow.
That's a rather forced comparison. But you may be right. Either way, those arts have been lost for eons.
I'm impressed, Aizen. You know a lot about everything.
Not at all. There's so much I don't know. For example, the name of these flowers. That's why I travel. To learn.
Eldina alabaster grass.
That's the name of this flower?
Yes. A long time ago, my brother showed me a picture of it in one of his books. They're fragile flowers. They die quickly on their own. But if enough of them gather together, they can survive. Fields of them form beautiful white carpets of flowers. In some cultures, they symbolize kinship. The bonds between people.
Kinship? Huh.
I'll remember that. You and your brother taught me something new today.
I'll never forget either.
Aww. People that knew stuff that Aizen didn't know. Look, the Dueling Peaks are back there. Now I just want to go play Zelda now. This whole landscape makes me want to go play Zelda right now. Can I get to this chest before I encounter whatever's in the middle of this field? It was crazy getting that flashback earlier where we heard once again what Velvet sounded like during the prologue, which I'm glad she doesn't sound like all the time, because that is, that's a hard voice to sit through. That's long term. But it shows what they lost.
This is the Earth Pulse point I've been feeling!
No Therian and no barrier.
I must have gotten it wrong again.
I wouldn't be so sure of that. That dragon could well have broken its barrier. Or it might have been too powerful for the Abbey to subdue.
You could be right. After all, dragons make for the strongest demons.
The problem is, we don't know if it's a Therian or not.
Yeah. Let's stick with the plan and head to Stonebury to gather more information.
Am I the only one here who thinks the real problem is how we're supposed to fight a frickin' dragon?
You stick him with the pointy bit. It's pretty straightforward. And then if he doesn't stop moving the first time, you hit him again. And repeat until he does stop moving. And then you win. That's how the fighting works. I did it. Surprisingly, Velvet can go careening off cliffs all the time, but only in very specific locations. Whee! Whenever there's a slight sloping, very accessible little ledge here and there, it's like, nope, impossible. Oh man, I could save so much time if she would jump off this. Where do we go? Whoa! So we need to find our way back to Stonebury. Right, okay. So that's why those things were blocked off earlier. Because I needed to visit the location of the Earth Pulse first, then go to Stonebury to actually investigate what's going on there. Uh-oh. Oh, yeah, I don't think his character model could fit correctly in that area, so I slipped past him. That's funny. I'm trying to think of whether or not I'm supposed to recognize Stonebury, or whether or not I will when I see it, and stuff like that. It's really hard to place a lot of this stuff. Like, sure, it's the same world, but many years earlier, like centuries earlier and all that, but it's just, these locations are so nondescript in many cases. Like, this is just an open field, and while I might recognize it within its own game, like, the geometry and landmarks of it aren't really a thing. Like, I'm not gonna be like, oh yeah, this room was totally shaped like that, and it had that spire there, and nailed it, got it all in my head. I can't really look at a place like in this game and immediately figure out whether or not it was location in the other game that takes place in the future, because it's just blobby open areas. It's nondescript. Like a lot of JRPG dungeons, really. I had the same comment about the Zestiria while I was playing it, but that just increased when we started playing a game that's sometimes trying to make callbacks to Zestiria, but a lot of the stuff kind of looks the same. Like, Artorias' throne is pretty much the primary thing that's like that looks like the place. Giant, weird staircase place with spires that leads to a top platform. Like, yeah, that's that's the closest thing this game has, in some cases, to a landmark, I'd say. In other cases, a place could look exactly the same and be completely unchanged. They could reuse a level, and I'd almost not recognize it still. Alright, did they start their new town then?
Alright, if I were a Bloodwing, where would I be?
We'll start at the inn. It only makes sense.
Raspberries, strawberries, blueberries. They all grow in abundance around Stonebury. We even have a fairy tale about it. One day the ground was covered with so many fallen berries, they all became stones.
Stoneberries? Is that how the town got its name?
The spelling has changed some, but yes. Berries are an important part of this village. We harvest local berries to make jams, pastries, gels, and all sorts of sweets.
Berry-flavored gels! I've never had one.
We've exported our jam and fruit for a while now, but our raspberry gels are still being perfected.
Aw, rats!
Are the vegetables growing in that field special too? I don't think I've ever seen anything like them before.
You've got sharp eyes. But that's right. They're a rare species of wild potato. They're red and they're called radish bells. We discovered them in the mountains nearby. Sadly, the potatoes are actually highly poisonous.
Really? They look so good.
They do. But the skin and the sprouts are toxic. If you aren't careful when removing them, it's Poisonville for you. Deadly poison aside, they're sweet, fluffy, and go great with butter. And when they're fried nice and crispy, they're the best.
So just skin them and sell them. What's the problem?
Yes, we've thought of that. But the way they are now, you have to peel off quite a bit before you get to the edible part. Peel one as big as your fist, and all you get for your trouble is a bit of meat the size of an egg yolk. That's why we're selectively breeding them. One day, they'll have only a thin layer of poisonous skin.
Why not breed them to get rid of the poison altogether?
With no poison, bugs will eat them, and they'll be more vulnerable to cold and heat. With potatoes, as with people, getting rid of everything harmful isn't always for the best.
So is Poisonville like your neighbor? Why would removing the poison make them more vulnerable to cold and heat? Or you just mean the skin? But I think Velvet was implying the idea of removing the poison from the skin, not removing the skin entirely from breeding.
Yay! I found so many blueberries!
What are you gonna do with all those? Make jam?
I'm going to feed them to my chickens. That way they'll lay eggs with purple yolks!
What? You know that won't work, right?
It sure will. The color of yolks change depending on what a hen eats. My grandma taught me that.
Actually, we always feed our chickens corn. Is that why their yolks are yellow? What are you gonna do with purple eggs anyway?
Tourists are coming from the capital again, right? I bet they've never seen purple eggs, so I figure I could sell them for a lot. Maybe I can even make our village famous!
You've thought this out. But will they really sell? You know what they'd make, right? Purple fried eggs, purple omelets, purple egg fried rice. Hey, would you want to eat a purple omelet?
Strange things sell, right? You don't have to be so mean just because you can't think of a better idea.
Sorry. Here, let me help you.
Fine. Go catch a whole barrel full of jewel beetles. If we feed them to my chickens, we'll get eggs with yolks like shining jewels.
I really wouldn't want to be your chickens, but... okay.
What a carefree village.
But you know, this is what really makes humanity amazing to me. Attempting the impossible. Reaching for the stars, just as a matter of course.
Aye. Though we may stumble countless times on our way, we can achieve anything we put our minds to.
Attempting the impossible, huh?
That's all well and good, but there are some lines that should never be crossed. Purple eggs.
Blech.
I don't know. Whenever I see an idyllic, hopeful village in a JRPG like this, that's so colorful, I'm just thinking it's gonna be on fire in about 5 minutes. Hey, you got 5 grand for the rainbow rock. There's, of course, the corrupted orb back there, and there's the serial killer tree. That name's amazing.
Stoneberry hasn't had much luck growing just yet, but this pioneer town has a lot of potential. Trees grow well here, and the lumber is of great quality. Oh, we're also close to the quarries, so stone isn't a problem. As long as the demons are contained, this country will rebuild. The need for stone and lumber will soar. Best of all, this area is quiet, has beautiful lakes, and is a perfect place for a craftsman like me to work.
And why settle for anything less?
I do feel that you might be a bit short-handed here. It's hard to build without manpower.
You're right. We need something to attract new settlers. Maybe some sort of specialty item?
Is there any fruit or vegetable that can only be found around here?
There is a type of potato called the radish bell that we grow, but it's got a few, quirks.
If you want to attract people, you should just ring a bell. Come to Stoneberry, where the money grows on trees. You need
sundries. A bell tower, huh? That might actually work. We can even use local stones for the bell. The Stoneberry Stone Belfry.
It won't work.
Huh?
Try hitting a rock. Doesn't ring.
Ah, how could I have missed that? I'm still such a novice. My master taught me better than this. Think before you build. That's what he always said. I need to do better and not sully his name.
Yeah, that was a rough one. I don't know how you thought that a stone bell was gonna work. I can actually do one. I'm so used to not being able to open these things anymore. Got laughing glasses. There's the mustache, that nightmare. The laughing glasses, oh my god. That's a problem. We will never speak of that again. The horns are actually like one of the rare accessories that might actually look good on various characters. Level 14, new zone. Let's go.
Scout ships.
Ta-da! That's about as much attention as I paid to that feature. But hey, I'm spamming it constantly, so I'm getting a bunch of cooking recipes and materials, so it's fine. That bush is rock solid and can't be passed.
I was on my way home from a trip to Logres, crossing the Aldina Plains, when I saw it. Rain was pouring as if from buckets, and the wind was so strong I could hardly stay on my feet. From the vast darkness of the sky, a monster of tremendous size descended, like the essence of the storm itself.
A huge flying demon?
At that moment, a group of exorcists leapt out from their hiding spots and began to battle the demon beast. But it met their swords with its fearsome horns, and a swipe of its tail threw the noble exorcist back.
Horns? And a tail?
Where did the demon go?
I couldn't tell you. I was so frightened, I ran away and never looked back. I hope the Abbey can get rid of it, but the beast took out 3 exorcists with a single blow. Come to think of it, another person was there too. He faced the demon and told it to stop.
Zavid.
If you're going to the Aldina Plains, you'd better be careful.
The water around here is ideal for producing wine and spirits. I've been thinking about fermenting something new.
What will you make? This region's specialty is berries, so a berry wine?
But the chilly air and level of humidity here should be just right for making an amber draft, don't you think?
Considering the geography around here, the water must contain a high mineral content. If you use it to make a rice wine, the taste will be unique.
I've considered all those options, but I must create something that can surpass my greatest rival, Sleeping Princess.
But that's nearly impossible to make.
Exactly. Not an easy task, to say the least. Sleeping Princess is made by filling an emerald cask with water from an enchanted mountain spring and sitting it in direct sunlight for 7 years. The water's magic causes it to change color each year. When it reaches the same deep green hue of the cask, it's ready.
Solar fermenting, huh? It won't be easy to surpass a marvel of the winemaking world like Sleeping Princess.
True, but I've finally found it. The ultimate stone.
A gemstone? Will you make a cask from it?
That would just make it an imitation. No. What I found can only be called a natural rock filter.
You're filtering wine with a rock?
Deep in the heart of these mountains, I found a stone that absorbs liquids. I tried using it to filter a berry wine. The taste of it was unbelievably crisp and bright. It preserved the luscious richness of the berries while adding a clarity that left me breathless. I call it Pure Land Wine. There is no better.
May I have a taste?
My apologies, but it took me 10 years to make a single thimbleful. I drank that thimbleful for my tasting. It'll be about 50 years before I can make a decent batch. I doubt I'll see a full bottle in my lifetime.
50 years, huh? Meet you back here, then?
I've never been so glad not to be human.
Well, well. I was about to say, the other wine we were talking about taking 7 years, I'm like, wow, sure, it's a good thing you're looking for a competition or some other alternate, because if you started making that, you'd probably be dead before it got finished at your age. Then it turns out his current strategy, he takes even longer. Welp, enjoy the afterlife as somebody else has your drinks. Yay?